Where do we begin? 1033 was a godsend, or devil send. And the reason why there are going to be so many devil references is because Oda has been subtly, I don't even think it's subtle, obviously making connections and references to the hell and devil, and the connections are done through Zoro. I don't have to say how spectacular this chapter was. I think when I think of Zoro now, it's almost like a dream. Everything I expected Zoro to get to, I wanted Zoro to get to, he's achieved already, right? Because I expected Luffy to be special, and we knew Zoro was special, but you can argue that he's right there with Luffy in regards to potential and then end of series expectation. We're gonna go back, right? But quickly, Luffy just learned Advanced Conquerors and coding. He just learned it. It's something that we felt like put him on another level. Zoro is using the same thing on all of his blades. That is impossible, okay? And Kaido even said it himself. Only a few, right? Not just a few, only a few of the very strongest can do something like that. So Zoro is not only special, he's special in the midst of other special people. That's insane. And he's Luffy's right hand man. So where are we going with this? First, we're going to talk about Enma, what exactly is happening here. Then talk about like how Enma was always supposed to be this sword. And let's talk about Oda's plan, how Ashura was always supposed to be through Enma, the demon of the underworld. And Ashura, that attack, how it goes hand in hand with that blade. And once we see Ashura again with the Conqueror's Haki coding from what Zoro's doing, it will be the most devastating attack that we've seen in the series. Probably behind the combined Yonko attack, but it's going to be devastating. So first, in chapter 1009, and first before we get to the chapter, I just got to talk about the cover art for chapter 1009, Zoro's drip, the three swords on the left sleeve. It's fantastic, right? But chapter 1009, right? I know that feels like ages ago because we're at chapter 1033. The title of that chapter was Hell. And not only did we see Conquest of the Sea, one of the strongest attack, if not the strongest attack in the series that Zoro proceeded to block, by the way, we saw Kaido use Three Realms Ragnaroku. So it's a bunch of different attacks that had references to the underworld, but that can prepare us for chapter 1010. So the translation notes from that chapter talks about the chapter title Hell and the references of the Buddhist concept of Hell, Naraku, as opposed to the usual word Jigoku, is a non-eternal purgatory which is earned via karma. And then also for Three Realms Ragnarok, the words mean pulled to hell, which is pretty much the apocalypse in Norse mythology. So Oda, again, a lot of references to the underworld and hell. Now let's get to chapter 1010. The title of that chapter being Conqueror's Haki. So in this chapter, we got the demonic nine sword style, Hell Hake Ashura. So with the references to hell, Zoro getting a sword named Enma, the demon of the underworld, seems almost fitting or too perfect or too good to be true. I've seen people try to dance around a topic about Zoro retaining Enma or if Enma goes back to Hiyori at No, this is Zoro's blade. It was always meant to be Zoro's. Zoro's path to this point led to Enma. So now it brings us to Enma, One Piece chapter 1033. Zoro has obviously ascended. And the reason behind the ascension isn't necessarily anything too crazy or dramatic. It's just understanding and acknowledgement. One thing that Yukimaru said that we can't forget, I keep talking about it, is the fact that he called Zoro selfish and ignorant. When Zoro talked about Black Blades, when he talked about Ryuma, he seemed to only think of himself, his goals, his beliefs. In this chapter, 1033, it seemed like Zoro finally thought about the sword. Wait, how did a sword like that from Wano get to the East Blue? He was trying to figure things out, understand things, think beyond himself, his goals, his kingly ambitions, and finally look at it and say, okay, let me think back about this sword. Let me try to understand this blade. In this relationship between Zoro and Enma and Zoro and his other blades, it's always been about what Zoro has wanted. I want to get stronger. If I master this sword, I will get stronger. But it's not just about mastering the blade, as Kazuburo tells us. It's also about bending the blade to your will, which he explains as the blades, they cut what they want to cut. That is what blades are built for. He said when they create a blade, they ensure that they can take as many lives as possible. They exist to cut people down, which is an interesting philosophy because Koshiro, Zoro sensei, said a sword can only cut what you want it to cut. That is his father. Now, for me, it was weird when I was going back through this because it seems like a contradiction. A blade can cut what you want it to cut, but your dad is saying blades are meant to cut people down. They ensure that they can take as many lives as possible. Both are correct, right? But it seems to be a philosophical difference here, where one feels like you can restrain the blade, you can control your blade, you can have a relationship with your blade in which it cuts what you want it to cut, and therefore more control. Then you have one on the other hand, where it's like the blade exists to cut people down. That's why they are created. So it's not about cutting what you want it to cut. It cuts everything. So one's about control and one's about force. Completely different in regards to philosophy and ideology, but it could be because of upbringing. Where Kazuburo grew up is completely different where Koshiro grew up. I believe Oda might explore this. Maybe Zoro notices the contradiction about what Koshiro taught him and also what Kazuburo told him. But I think in regards to mastering Enma, a bit of both is necessary. Some care, some finesse, but also some brute strength, some bending of the will. It's gonna go somewhere because it's such an obvious thing. I expected Kazuburo to just say, hey, cut what you want to cut, just enforce the breath of all things, everything that we've known. But no, he say a sword is meant to do this. My sword, my magnum opus Enma, I named it after the Lord of the Underworld. That's how devastating that blade is. Now, if you tame a sword and bend it to your will, at the end of the day, you're only gonna cut what you want to cut, but you can't ignore those words about a sword being made to cut as many people down as possible. I love it because it's adding some more value, in my opinion, to Zoro's journey. We all love Zoro, but something in regards to his journey to become the world's greatest, it's felt hollow. Okay, Zoro's gonna become the world's strongest. We haven't had really a blueprint on how to get there. It's just been beat Mihawk. What about the journey, which I think is the best part, right? In regards to achieving your goal, the struggle, the checkpoints. So far, there haven't been as many checkpoints. We got some in Thriller Bark, I guess post time skip. Wano can absolutely change the trajectory of all that. Of course, I would like some more candidates, but Zoro learning more about this blade and learning more about himself will be the key to him unlocking, obviously, the Black Blade, but there's also something here. Along with the disposition of the swords and the personality, pretty much, of the swords, it is forcing Zoro to go beyond his limits, in which he's risking his life. In chapter 1010, Zoro said something to Law, saying, hey, Law, this is the limit of my ability. He was wrong. What we saw from Zoro versus Kaido, I think, is the tip of the iceberg, or the tip of the sword, because Zoro consciously or unconsciously placed a limit on himself because he was scared to die. We go back to Rayleigh, who preaches the message of no doubt that is true power. So mentally, Zoro placed a limit on himself in regards to haki and drawing as much out of the blade as possible. So therefore, his potential was capped for that specific interaction. What Enma does is forces you to surpass your limits, which consciously you don't even know you can tap into. It's almost as if there's a reserve of Kyuubi chakra that Zoro doesn't even know he has inside him. Of course, there's no nine-tailed fox inside of Zoro, but there is an entire reserve of power that Zoro can tap into that Enma is allowing him because it is releasing the constraints of limits in his mind, because at this point his life is on the line, and that is necessary to remove theoretical ceiling that Zoro has placed on himself. That is not the limit of your ability. Now, Zoro, you have the Conqueror's Haki coding, which of course for Conqueror's Haki, there seems to be no end or no limit to how much you can use in battle, but there's definitely a limit to it. We don't know what that limit is, but I believe it will coincide with his limit in regards to his stamina. Enma is the perfect sword for Zoro, not only because of what it does for him, but because of what it was made for. Yes, right now it's about drawing out as much as possible, but the control, the bending, the relationship, the learning, this is integral for Zoro to not only grow stronger, but for Enma to raise its rank. Zoro has kingly ambitions, so I think that mindset, there's no limit to your ability. That picture of Kaido stating, Luffy, could he surpass these people? Is he on the level of these people? We need to add Zoro to that list. He's clearly proven that he belongs there. And what Enma is doing is removing all doubt because he understands what's on the line. He understands if I don't fight this way, I will never be able to defeat someone like King. So I believe King also has a trump card because I absolutely believe he's a conqueror as well. I know I talked about King being Zoro's Katakuri fight per se, but I'm not sure if I'm willing to say that King teaches Zoro how to code his attacks better. Now it would make sense if King is a Conqueror's Haki user, can code his attacks, and decides not to do that, even though he is that strong. I think it would add to King. It would make the clashes amazing. So yeah, I'm probably gonna jump out and say it. King has Conqueror's Haki coding as well. But if King does, that'd be so crazy. All right, let me stop fanning out for a second because I'm losing my mind here. This chapter was so good. But guys, give me your thoughts. How do you feel about all this? Amazing chapter. Expect an exciting breakdown tomorrow. I really can't wait. What do you think about Zoro? What do you think his limit is? What do you think his ceiling is? Yeah, give me your thoughts. Make sure to like the video if you did. Subscribe to the channel for more more content like this, follow me on Twitter at BragoDAce. Follow me on Instagram at BragoDAce. Thank you to my patrons. I appreciate you guys all so much. Again, guys, like and subscribe, and I'll catch you in the next one. Peace.
Start doubting me, I felt lost.